HarperCollins presents The Dark Tide by Simon McCleave, read by Alice White. Anglesey. There is a word in Welsh that has no exact translation into English. Hiraeth. It is best defined as the bond you feel with a place, a mixture of pride, homesickness, and a determination to return. Most people that have visited Anglesey leave with an understanding of Hiraeth. Prologue. West Manchester, 12th of August 2018. Detective Inspector Laura Hart of the Greater Manchester Police, or the GMP, sat quietly in the back of an armed response vehicle as it drove slowly out from behind the disused petrol station where it had been hidden for the last 10 minutes. It turned left and headed towards Branning's warehouse on the Central Park trading estate, situated to the west of Manchester. She was sharing the stuffy vehicle with four armed response officers, AROs, in full combat equipment. Within the police, AROs were referred to as SHOTs, and they were clad in black helmets, perspex goggles, balaclavas, Kevlar bulletproof vests, and Heckler & Koch G36C assault rifles. The G36C carried a 100-round C-Mag drum magazine and fired at the deadly rate of 750 rounds per minute. In an operation like this, the AROs needed more firepower than the 9mm pistols or carbines that they usually carried. They weren't going to take any risks today. As the armoured BMW X5 slowed, Laura reached up to hold onto the leather strap that hung from the car roof to keep her balance. She could feel the adrenaline surging through her body. She felt agitated and highly alert. Her Kevlar bulletproof vest was heavy as it bounced against her shoulders. As always, it was too big. She was a diminutive 5'4", which meant even the smallest vest, with its heavy armour plating, jolted around her body and left scratches and bruises. Why can't they make a vest that fits me? It's not as though I'm an elf, is it? She thought dryly to herself. If wearing a vest had been a rare occurrence, she might not have minded. But because of the escalation in the number of armed gangs in Manchester, she was permanently putting one on. Part of her found it annoying, as she had never received as much as a scratch while on these operations. The other part of her thought of her kids, Jake, aged 8, and Rosie, 15. There can always be a first time, she told herself. You're not bloody immortal. Laura was 43 years old, blonde, with arched brows that framed her large, expressive chestnut eyes. She wore a permanent expression of reassurance, whether it was on a police operation like today, or holding the hand of her son as he walked along the top of a high wall. The inside of the ARV was silent, except for the crackle of the Tetra police radio and the mumbled voice of Gold Command giving the driver instructions. It smelt of gun oil, male sweat and stale cigarettes. Looking over at the young ARO next to her, she got a waft of his chewing gum as he stared at the floor, readying himself for the operation. As he scratched his dark beard, he sensed her gaze and looked up at her. You okay, ma'am? He had a thick Yorkshire accent. Laura nodded. Never better, she replied sardonically. Her accent had a trace of North Wales. He grinned. Just keep behind us, eh? We don't want you having to use that thing, he said protectively, and then gestured to the Glock 19 pistol in the holster on her belt. She smiled back at him. Neither did she. It might have 15 bullets in it, but she had never fired a gun in over 20 years as a police officer, other than at the police firing range. She glanced back to the road behind where another ARV BMW followed them. Today was Operation Solar. A reliable covert human intelligence source, the overcomplicated police vernacular for a snout, a grass or an informant, had identified the disused Branning's warehouse as a major drugs factory for the Fallowfield Hill Gang, a notorious and powerful organised crime group in South Manchester. The gang's formation and roots went back as far as the early 70s, and they had been part of the eruption of gang warfare in the 90s that saw over 300 shootings in 5 years. The UK tabloid press had renamed Manchester Gunchester at the time. However, the gang had become nervous and volatile after the arrest of their two leaders, Lee Jennings and Tyrone Amos, for a drive-by shooting at the funeral of a member of the Doddington gang. Manchester CID had intel that the gang members they were on their way to intercept, who were running the manufacture of crack cocaine, were heavily armed. The driver spoke into the radio. Gold Command, Sierra Oscar 5, are you receiving? Over. Gold Command, the officer in charge of Operation Solar, was Superintendent Ian Butterfield. He would be watching the operation in the warm safety of West Didsbury Nick via remote cameras placed in the ARV and the helmet of the lead ARO, Sergeant Phillips. Laura didn't rate Butterfield as an on-the-ground copper. He was a political animal, more interested in schmoozing and working his way up the career ladder. He had no interest in straightforward police work, as his time and energy were spent dropping poison into people's ears and watching his back in case there was a knife headed for it. And that made him a dangerous liability on operations like this. Gold Command to Sierra Oscar 5, receiving, go ahead. Over. Gold Command acknowledged. Sierra Oscar 5, we have arrived at the target destination. Out, replied the driver. Stand by. Laura unclipped her seatbelt and opened the door. Phew, it's even hotter outside than in the ARV. Getting out slowly, she gazed up at the concrete warehouse. A few of the windows on the first floor were boarded up and covered in red graffiti. It looked dilapidated and abandoned, no doubt the reason why it had been chosen for a covert drugs factory. She clicked her radio on and spoke. 5-3 to Gold Command, we are approaching target location, over. In their well-rehearsed technique, the AROs fanned out and moved swiftly towards the flank wall of the warehouse in total silence. It was going to be CQC once they were inside. Close quarter combat, which entailed moving quickly through a series of rooms and corridors until the suspects were captured or nullified. A rusty, graffitied sheet of aluminium that covered a doorway shook noisily in the wind, as if warning the gang of their presence. Two blackbirds, possibly ravens, flew from behind the doorway and up into the air, eventually resting on the filthy guttering above, where they squawked and chattered loudly. She heard the faint sound of a police siren in the distance. It had become the incessant backdrop to many parts of Manchester in recent years. It's very quiet, she thought. Too quiet, maybe? There was a whoosh as the wind picked up again, and a discarded can of Coke rattled and skittered boisterously across the concrete ground beside her. She felt uneasy. Glancing to her right, she saw the AROs fan out further as they moved into position, crouching low against the building. They weren't going any further until everything was secure. Three of them reached to their belts and took out G60 stun grenades. There was a sudden glint of light as a window on the first floor moved slightly and caught the sunlight in its glass. What was that? Her heart now pounded against her chest. Was someone watching them from inside? Did they already know they were there? How could they know we were coming? Her pulse quickened as she approached the derelict doorway that had been covered by the rattling aluminium sheet. She listened for a moment. It really is too quiet, she thought. Moving back, she peered through the smeared glass of a downstairs window to see nothing but an empty shell of a room. Not a single movement to indicate anyone was inside. Maybe the intel had been wrong. It wouldn't have been the first time they'd turned up to find that a gang had been tipped off and cleared out. It had become a worrying pattern. CID was full of rumours about a leak. Was one of her fellow officers really bent and taking money to keep the OCGs one step ahead of them? Taking a breath to calm her nerves, she glanced back at the AROs who still hunkered down by the wall. One of them shook his head to show he hadn't seen anything either. Looks like we're going in. She clicked her radio on as she took a few steps away from the warehouse and glanced up at the first floor again. Gold Command from 5-3, over. Gold Command, receiving, over. 5-6, I'm at the target location, but we have no visual on suspects. Entry team is in final assault position, over. Gold Command received. Proceed with caution. Crack, 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 crack! Before she could react, bullets hit the ground beside her foot, throwing dust and dirt into the air. Jesus! The burst of automatic gunfire was deafening. All the firearms used by the GMP were configured to not fire on semi-automatic, so the sound of the automatic gunfire was particularly frightening to the police officers, because they knew it couldn't be them firing. They were under enemy fire. Laura flinched and jumped backwards. She glanced up at a window where a man in a balaclava held some kind of assault rifle to his shoulder. Another flash from the gun's muzzle and she dived for cover. Crack, crack, crack! Bloody hell, they did know we were coming. The air above her exploded like an ear-piercing fireworks display. Move, move, you're a sitting bloody duck, Laura. She crawled across the grimy concrete towards the cover of the warehouse wall. Jesus H. Christ! Crack, crack, bang! Shouting, glass breaking, a yell. An ARO appeared beside her and shouted, "You okay, ma'am?" "Yeah, just about," she gasped over the din. Her breathing was shallow, her heart thumping, but she didn't think she'd suffered more than a bruised knee and grazed palms from diving to the floor. "Right, ma'am, I need to get you back to the ARV. Come with me, I've got you covered," shouted the ARO as he grabbed her bulletproof vest and yanked her away from the wall. He wasn't really giving her much choice in the matter. The sound of gunfire was ear-splitting as they sprinted across the ground to safety behind the ARV. A bullet zipped over her head. "Thanks," Laura said, hitting the ground behind the vehicle. The bullets from the gang members inside the warehouse hammered into the ARV's bodywork with a series of loud, frightening metallic thuds that rocked the vehicle. "Jesus, please let me get out of here today." The faces of her children flashed through her mind, and she winced at another burst of gunfire. "Gold Command from 5-6. Code 0. Code 0. Officers under fire. I repeat, officers under fire," she yelled into her radio. The air was full of thunderous noise and the smell of cordite. The ARO opened the back door of the BMW. "Ma'am, we need to get you out of here. We're outnumbered." Her radio crackled. "Gold Command to 5-6, we have reports of two uniformed officers inside the target location. Over." What did he say? "Can you repeat, over?" she hollered. The noise of gunfire made it hard to hear anything. "Repeat, we have reports of two uniformed officers inside your target location. Over." What the hell are they talking about? How could two uniformed police officers be inside the warehouse? As the AROs retreated and scuttled back towards their ARVs, the gunfire from the warehouse started to subside a little. 5-6 received. "Why weren't we told this intel earlier, over?" she growled. It was information that would have changed their whole approach to the operation and their attempt to storm the warehouse. 5-6, apparently there was a delay somewhere in dispatch, over. Well, that's not bloody good enough, she thought. Those officers could have been killed if we'd gone in with all guns blazing. "Do we have any more details on the officers inside, over?" she asked, fighting to keep the anger out of her voice. Her ears were ringing incessantly. "Gold Command to 5-6. Officers' names are PC Sam Hart and PC Louise MacDonald. They were on a routine call-out when they entered the target premises, over. We believe we now have a hostage situation, over." Laura felt sick at the news as she mumbled. "Gold Command received." An ARO pushed her into the back of the car and slammed the door behind her. The side window exploded, showering them in glass. "Let's go!" an ARO yelled. Panic threatened to overwhelm her as the ARV started to pull away. "Stop the car!" she yelled. Her head was spinning with what she'd just been told. The ARV slammed on its brakes, throwing everyone forward sharply. As Laura grasped the handle, as if to open the vehicle door, an ARO stretched out his gloved hand to stop her. "Ma'am, We need to get you out of here or we're going to get killed. She looked at him pleadingly and said, I need to get out. Please.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.